writing songs. How is it possible that I can be so in love with Arab music? You know, Caroline from the Consul General was just telling me now, this music transports you. My mother speaks Arabic. If you come to our bar mitzvahs and our weddings and our simchas, it's Arab music. How is it possible that I'd be so in love with Arab culture? I'm the proudest Jew I know. And there's something about when I hear Arab music that just transports me. Even when my mother speaks Arabic, there's a professor in UCLA who is Muslim, he's from Morocco. And he's one of the world experts on Moroccan Jews. So he comes to my house for Shabbat. He's been there many times. His name is Omar, amazing guy. Call him my brother. So my mother was in town from Montreal. She was cooking, and they were speaking in Arabic. They're like from the same family. She's cooking food, Sephardic food, and he's telling her this is the same food that I ate growing up in Morocco as a Muslim Arab, right? It's unbelievable. How do you deal with this stuff, right? Because it's a day of commemoration, and they're so complicated, because I can't tell you how happy I am that we left. You know? But then I go back, and it pulls me, and I have memories of Mimouna and the Jewish ghettos of Casablanca, right? And they're like amazing memories. And all the doors were open in the neighborhood of all the Jewish homes. And I was a little kid, 6 years old, 7 years old, and it's all this craziness after Pesach, because you're transitioning from, you know, matzah to bread, and the Arabs are bringing us all the stuff that we need, and the flour, and there's all this, you know, madness that, everyone's got to prepare all these amazing sweet tables. And for hours and hours, we just run around from one house to another, because it was Mimouna. It was the magical night, right? And I had these memories from Morocco. And then, you know, a few years later, it's minus 20 in Montreal, and it's miserable. You know, because we moved. We moved. It was 1964. And I remember, because this is a night of remembering. So let's remember. So I remember, in Montreal, things would come into the apartment, and it was free. And I would always ask my mother, you know, like furniture would come, and then dishes and covers, and we had jackets. And we had red jackets, we had red hats, right? So I would always ask my mother, where does all this stuff come from? And she would always say, la chayas, la chayas, la chayas. In French, you don't say hayas, you say chayas. You spell the J, right? So I was a little kid, 9 years old, and I'm hearing that this thing called the Jayas keeps giving us free stuff. Little did I know that 40 years later, I would be at a fundraiser in Beverly Hills for Jayas, right? And it all came back retroactively. This was my introduction to Jewish solidarity. And it was retroactive. It was like, oh my God. So there was some, probably a fundraiser in Beverly Hills in 1964. And somebody was saying, you know, we have our Jewish brothers and sisters in Morocco who need our help. And they couldn't take any of their money with them. And we need to take them to wherever they need to go, whether it's Canada, France, or Israel, and step up. And Ashkenazi Jews stepped up. They had no idea I had one eyebrow and I looked like an Arab. They didn't know who I was, they didn't know my face. But they knew Suissa was a Jew. And there were lots and lots of us, and I stepped up. This was my introduction to Jewish solidarity. Ashkenazi Jews stepping up for Sephardic Jews just because I was Jewish. And I remember in the schools we went to in Montreal, if ever I would see a red hat, I knew it was a Sephardic guy, because they would get quantity discounts with the jackets. So they had a lot of red hats. So that was my... There was a little sign. So it's really a complicated story. My grandfather, God bless him, 11 children, He had this great business in Casablanca selling spices and teas. He was doing really well. But his two of his boys, when they heard 1947, the news is out, they went to fight in the War of Independence. And then he takes six more children in 1952, and yeah, they suffered. They had to leave, and they left. He left everything behind. And they go into a little developmental town near Ashkelon called Shikun Drumi. They give him a little shack. Yes, somebody from Shikun Drumi, beautiful, unbelievable. It's funny, when I went to visit him years later when I was a hippie hitchhiking with no money and a bus lands me at night in Shikun Drumi, all I had to do was ask for Yamin Biton. I asked this guy smoking Thai man cigarettes and he took me right to my grandfather's house. So it was a little shack, right? Little house. And seven kids in one bedroom and him and my grandmother in the other. And he went from being a great businessman in Casablanca to a little kiosk in Ashkelon. Little kiosks selling candy and stuff, right? But here's the catch. When he landed in Israel, he kissed the ground and said, I'm never leaving because I'm coming home, right? So it's a complicated story. It's a complicated story. He leaves a really comfortable life in Casablanca, but he's a religious man. So if you're a religious man, you're praying three times a day to return home to Zion. It's in our blood. Do you know that of all the things I tell my children to instill in them a Jewish pride? And God knows I got a big mouth, I talk a lot. God knows I've told them a lot of things. So I'm trying to put the odds on my side. I think the most powerful one I've ever said to them is when we sit down with the Kiddush on Friday night, I said to them, you know, just think, you know, 1,000 years ago, a little village somewhere in Morocco, your grandparents, your puppies and Sadies, were sitting in some little table, you know, and they were lighting the Shabbat candles like we did, making the exact same kiddush we're making now. It's impossible. How could that be, right? For me, that's a bigger miracle than the splitting of the Red Sea. So this idea of continuity that we have kept on is for me the most powerful story. So when we're asked to remember today, on this day of commemoration, I don't just remember that we were victims when we left. We were victims. My grandfather did suffer. I have to say that Morocco was not exactly the same experience. As we saw in the film, if many of you probably know that the number one advisor to the king, his name is André Azoulay, and he's a Jew. And the king's father was known. Take care of the Jews. When I went back to Morocco 12 years ago, there's a Jew that got killed that day. His name was Amram. He was a guy who worked in wood. The next day, there was a full-page ad from the king apologizing to the Jewish community. They're all torn up that we left. There were 300,000 Jews in Morocco, and now there's less than 3,000. My friends, my Arab friends, are torn up that we left because we contributed so much. So that's also another thing to remember, is how much they lost, how much the Arab countries lost. But I can't help thinking how much we've gained. Because when I hear about our rights and we remember our rights, I also remember our obligations. So for me, I also remember that today is a day of solidarity. It's a day that reminds me how good Jews are at taking care of each other. And like the rabbi Sesler was saying, I long for the day when our Arab neighbors could do as well as we do when it comes to taking care of each other. I want to tell them, look at our story of refugees and take care of your own the way we did. Take care of your own the way we did. Why won't you take care of your own? Why won't you take care of your own? Millions and millions of refugees leaving Syria. Meanwhile, there are hundreds and thousands of these amazing boats in Saudi Arabia, completely empty. Why won't they take care of their own? Why won't all those Arab countries help take care of their Palestinian brothers and sisters? So this story, as much as it hurts me to think of how we suffered, as much as it hurts me to hear the stories of persecution, whether it was in Iraq or Lebanon or Egypt or Syria, as much as it hurts me, I'm still reminded of how great it is to be Jewish. Because for me, the story of commemoration of the Jews for Arab countries is a victory in a way. It's a story of our incredible ability to survive no matter what. And it's that thing that we've got, that ability to recite the same Kiddush century after century after century. You know, it's very, very popular to say Jews are so different. We have so many differences, especially in Los Angeles, one of the most diverse communities on the planet when it comes to Judaism. And it's common. You hear it all the time. We're so different. And it's true. You know, I go to a Sephardic minyan. It's a lot closer to a mosque minyan than it is to an Ashkenazi minyan. On Yom Kippur and the high holidays, in the morning, I go to a Sephardic minyan on Magen David. In the afternoon, I take my boy, we walk to Yik, then Ashkenazi, because I want my boy to see both, right? Completely different. You would think we would be in a completely different galaxy. It's so different, you can't imagine. The foods are different, we look different, the singing is different, the melodies are different. Our differences go on forever. When we had Young Israel in Century City, they have great acoustics, so I wanted the bar mitzvah to be there. I went there right away. I said, I'm Sephardi, I'm Ashkenazi, I'm not Yeshua. I feel I should do the bar mitzvah in Yeshua. He said, David, you know. And I said, you know, I have all my family, Sephardi, they're coming from Montreal, you know, we're Sephardi. David, we've never done Sephardi in this synagogue, we're playing Ashkenazi, blah, blah, blah. I said, but for you, we might make an exception, right? Thank you. So, we did a Sephardic service at Young Israel. Amazing. Mashiach was right around the corner. Unbelievable. A Sephardic, the most Ashkenazi shul in L.A. And then what was the reaction? It was unbelievable. All my Ashkenazi friends, oh my God, I thought we were a great shul. Little did I know how great we could even be. We could even be greater. There was just an unbelievable amount of embracing and love and so forth. But what was the point? That all the melodies were so different, but the words were the same. So when you think that the temple gets destroyed in the year 70, and for 19 centuries we wander around the globe, just imagine my ancestor in the year 70, saying he was maybe buddies with Rabbi Sestler's ancestor, and they say, "I'll see you in 1900 years." And they meet 1900 years later on Fairfax. And guess what? They go to shul, and nothing has changed. They're reading the same Torah. Unbelievable. And he invites them to his house for Shabbat, and guess what? They're reciting the same Kiddush and the same blessings. That for me is a miracle. So when I hear that Jews are different, I said, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? So this thing that binds us, but it's because we look different, because our melodies are different and our foods are different, that we're able to see how much we have in common. So that's another thing I remember today on this day of commemoration. I remember that leaving Morocco, being one of the 850,000, has enabled me to live out what I call the grand family reunion of the Jewish people. My great-grandfather in Morocco never met an Ashkenazi Jew. Neither did his father or his father. And I'm here, especially at the Jewish Journal. I hear it from all the Jews. You know, the thing, there's got to be 100 nationalities of Jews here. That's a blessing. So that's also something else I remember on this day of commemoration. I remember that I've been able to live out this grand family reunion that we're blessed to be part of. So at the end, as we go forward in the future years of commemorating this day, which I think it's a fantastic idea that the Israeli government has initiated this, and I hope it becomes one of those days that just grows every year, that we just add on, just it gets better and better and better. And I hope it becomes a global idea. And that part of this global idea, I hope the idea of solidarity makes its way into this narrative. Because it's one of the things that I'm most proud of being a Jew, this ability that I can ask any of you tonight. If there's a Jew suffering in Argentina, you'll stand up in it. This idea of solidarity, I think, is one of the greatest gifts we can show the world, to take care of our own, and to remember each other, and to have this sense of solidarity at a time when it might be politically incorrect to even say it. But I'm never afraid to say it, because I think it's an example we can give to the world, this idea of being able to take care of our own. So that's something that I remember on this day of commemoration. And then the last thing, it's just a little story about holding the hand of my father on the night of Yom Kippur at Neila. We all have, you know, memories. It's the night of memories. And it was the one day, you know, I had an interesting journey because, you know, I came to California, I started experimenting, you know, two different things, you know, I was a hippie and stuff, and somehow it was something that always kept me connected to Judaism. It was this one melody of Neila. Hold my father's hand, and we're very hungry, and you can feel everybody was hungry. It was the end, you know, 24 hours, we're trying to open the gates of heaven. And the Sephardic tradition is everybody comes in front, and you see they open up and the ark, and then you cover yourself with the your talus, and then you start singing, Enor Alila, Enor Alila, Amsila no mechila, Anehila. And it's like goosebumps, you know? And I remember being a kid, I would hold my father's hand, and there's like a whole bunch of us, and it's like you're singing to open the gates of heaven. And it struck me that there's something going on here. And it never hit me until I held my boy's hand. In LA, I held my boy's hand. And we were singing it again. You know? And I remember that when I held my father's hand, I was holding the hands of his ancestors, going way back to the temple. And I was holding my boy's hand. I was also holding my descendants, you know? And it struck me that no matter where we were, whether we were refugees, whether we were happy, whether we were persecuted, no matter what, we held our hands and we sang Neila. And that's what I want to leave you with that one thought of solidarity and continuity. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen,